What's going on, YouTube? In today's video, we're going to be getting something a little bit different here than what you traditionally get to see, and that is going to be a Black Yellow Luffy overview. My man Jay, all the way from France, who is a Treasure Cup winner, who has topped in regionals over there with Black Yellow Luffy, is going to be giving us a rundown of the two main versions of the deck that you guys can be expecting to see in 7.5 and 8 coming up. If you're watching this and want to get coaching, you can sign up today using the link above here or down below. Jay is an incredible person, a really good teacher, describes things super well, and so you guys will be seeing it here today, the two different versions as we talk about it and then getting to some examples. So let's get right into it.
You started with this one? Okay.
Either or is fine. I think that this is kind of like
the more standard build, yeah.
The more standard. Oh wait, this one doesn't have Ice Age, huh?
No, there is not 50 card in this deck list. There is 47 at the moment.
Okay. But yes.
So you have flexible spot here, okay?
I see.
So this right here is pretty much like the main core of the deck that you might see like most of the time, like if you play Ace, right? So it's pretty standout. You just max out everything and you just make sure to be as aggressive as possible. And then you still have some space for extra cards that you could just put in, you know. And there is different tech cards that you can just add in the BY Luffy deck. And they are not all bad. Like my students that ask me like, which cards should I take? Like this Thunderbolt, Ice Age, Kuzan, Ivankov. Like they ask me about everything. But just keep in mind that at the end of the day, it's most likely up to preferences. Like none of them are that bad. Even though sometimes on stream we might troll and say like, oh, decklist is inconsistent, decklist is bad, this shit, you know, shit deck or something like that. They are all not too bad. But I think are we talking OP 07 or OP 8 though?
OP 7, I guess for into now, eight. But I mean, it kind of sets us up for OP 08 too, right? Because I mean, does the deck list really change that much in OP 08?
Yeah, I think so. I think we will see a lot of changes, to be honest.
Oh, okay. So
this deck list at the moment, this is pretty much something that I would recommend because low is not banned yet. There is still tournaments going on with low. I'm doing a Treasure Cup actually Saturday and low is not banned during that Treasure Cup. And overall, I think in our current meta, this deck list is something that I think it's better than the control approach of BY Luffy.
Okay.
Just because Ace is just doing so much work in many matchup and the ratios are just that big that the deck is really consistent. So you have 11 babies in this deck list, which means that the odds of you finding a baby in your starting hand are like 28%.
Okay.
Compared to if you only have like, I think it was 10 baby, it goes down to 24 or something like that. I don't remember like the exact numbers, but it was roughly around that. And if you have 12 babies, it's 32%. So it's still pretty high that you're going to get a baby and you need those babies to do the engine. So just imagine, though, if you only have 8 babies, right? It's not that crazy, right? It's roughly like not even 20% to have a baby in your starting hand. But the deck would be played differently as well.
Okay. So then why don't we say, fuck, even though there's some tournaments that have, you know, red that are still pre-ban and stuff like that, let's go 7.5 and then kind of like what you can expect for 8 then.
Okay. I think
you just tell me to switch if you want me to go to the other list.
So for this list, you could add either Ice Age to just have some kind of removal to just get rid of 9-cost Zoro, 8-cost Kid, or even Moria, Isho, you know, all of those big bodies, Yamato, Katakuri. It's just a little plus, you know, just something that sometimes you might be in a spot where you don't feel that comfortable and Ice Age can just put some work over here, you know. You can also add Thunderbolt just to get rid of a lot of 5 cost, like 5 cost Kid, Cavendish. Those cards are really annoying for BY Luffy. Mm-hmm. So Thunderbolt in a way is a little bit more versatile and useful against like all of the leaders in our meta.
Yeah, and I hate it when they Thunderbolt my Zombie Luffy.
Yeah, exactly. Zombie Luffy as well, since he's been tech quite often now.
Yeah.
It's a good answer for that. Okay. On top of just getting rid of one of your life, that helps you to just save a 2k, because to take your life, you need to use the 2k if you don't have the 5 cost Luffy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So Thunderbolt is also a good choice, a good pick here.
So you're saying that this is this list here, you would still be running Ace even going into 08 per se, because like some people in chat, for example, are saying that like, you know, they take out the Ace in 08.
We still need to see how the meta will be, because keep in mind that the meta that they have in Asia is much more different than we have in Europe and here in America in NA.
Mm-hmm.
And also keep in mind that the meta that they are having whenever the new OP is being released, like for example, 09 is going to be released, right? They're going to have a meta, their own meta. And when 09 is going to be released for us, the meta would have probably changed already, and it's going to change as well. So the meta keep changing, as so for the deck list pretty much. Mm-hmm. So you kind of have to just evolve alongside with that. At the moment, in my opinion, it's just crazy to not run Ace at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
For 07, like Ace is just that good, but for 08 we might lean toward a control approach. Like I test the other list.
Mm-hmm. So this is the other list.
Yeah, so this is the other list that I've been topping recently in I think it's Sydney. So like a BY Luffy guy ended up second. He lost in final against Red Popolo.
It's because they were from Asia, I'm pretty sure.
Oh,
they invaded the Sydney regionals.
Where they actually did that?
No. Actually, though, I'm pretty sure. I think, was it, who was it? Who the fuck was it?
I don't know the names, though. It's just,
hold on, let me see.
But yeah, he lost. So I look at his pairings. I watch the final. I look at the deck list. So I think like everyone was pretty much surprised to see that kind of deck list just topping, you know, for many reasons, like 4 cost Kuzan maxed out, 10 cost Kuzan, Shigan.
Yep.
I think Shigan is pretty much the card that just everyone was like, what the fuck?
Yeah. Oh, it was Gavin. Yeah. Gavin. Yep. It's like it's the Seafood King boys and like just that whole friend group. They went over there, like Sky. They did pretty well. Newbie was there.
Okay, so it was like a whole bunch of guys from the same place that just go to that regional and
to
smash it.
yep. But I mean, that's where we see kind of like this list, and I guess now it's being more popularized for sure.
So I tested for like two to three days because I was curious about it.
Mm-hmm.
So at the moment, my takes on it is just I don't like it, but it's just my opinion. It's just because it's less consistent.
Mm.
It's less consistent because you only have 8 babies, and against some leaders, it's going to be tough to do your engine, and you will try to just run after your pieces, you know? Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much what I saw from the finals, is that he was always missing a piece.
Mm.
And with only 8 babies, 20 target, and 6 searchers, just to let you know, the first game that I did with that list, I used a search and I whiffed, and I was like, all right, that's exactly what I thought it would be. Uh-huh. I whiffed straight up, first search whiffed, and I was like, shit. So I think you have to play much more different with that kind of list and play a little bit like a standard deck. You would just want to, you don't want to lose your life too fast. You just want to play the 4 cost Kuzan, even play the Moria before the... Like, usually we play Moria after we start the engine. You know, mm-hmm. we start the engine, then we play Moria just to save some resources and play a big buddy. Then in this list, you might just want to play Moria to bring back Kuzan.
Yeah, it's like Kuzan if, and if Garp, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. If they kill Kuzan, then it's fine. Just play Moria, bring them back. Mm-hmm. And then you play Moria just to play Moria. And then on 9 Dawns, it just make it even more harder for them to get rid of Moria and Kuzan. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like a little bit back then when you were playing Moria against Moria, right? if you were playing Moria on 8 Dawns, you knew that, like I'm talking about the leaders, right? Moria mm-hmm. against Moria. The Moria that plays the 8 cost Moria on 8 Dawn plus Kuzan, he knows that one of those will stick to the board because the other Moria cannot get rid of both of them at the same time. Like, there is no way.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there is no way out. And that's pretty much the same here, except that Lucci can get rid of both of them, but it might ask, like, a lot of resources to do so on 9 Dawns, pretty much.
Yeah.
And it's just putting extra pressure. Like, to be honest, in BY Luffy, you play 4-cost Kuzan, it dies, you just don't give a fuck. It's just that's straight up the thing. It's like, Kuzan dies, it's fine. The deck is not made around the Kuzan. The deck is made around the rest of the engine, pretty much, because that's where it is good. And if Kuzan sticks, then everything just, boom, you know, it's even more stronger, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so that kind of deck list, if you high roll, as insanely good, and it's especially against black deck. It is really good against black decks.
Yeah.
But
I encountered it a couple times now, and
yeah, I mean, when we play against Noel, you could definitely see like what we are knowing, like because you have to deal with the 5-cost Luffy, and then after that there is 4-cost Kuzan. You're like, shit, I need to get rid of both of them. How am I gonna do that? You know. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So you just have to understand whenever you have to get rid of Kuzan and whenever you have to get rid of Luffy, when it's too late, when it's not too late. It's pretty much evaluating the pros and cons of that. Another thing with that list could be a little bit more bricky as well. You know, when you keep drawing after the Shigan into the Kuzan and you're like, shit, not having any 2Ks, not having any 1K or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be rough. And also, why I would not recommend this list, at least in Europe, or even in NA, I don't know for you, but here, Nami has been played a lot. And this list against Nami, I'm not sure he can win this. He can win Nami, to be honest. Because you don't have Ace, and uh-huh. you're lacking of babies. And you have less searchers. So, how are you just gonna try to find your 5-cost Luffy and the Ace and the Rockets, you know, it's just... I think against Nami, this list might not do so well. And against Blue overall, I would say, like even Blue Duffy, you might struggle a little bit more because you have less pressure, you have more removal. But against Blue, you kind of want to play around your hand size, like managing your card in your hand, rather than just going wide and taking your time. Because the more cards you have in your hand, because this list is made to not lose any card advantage, kind of, through Kuzan, you know, you just want to keep, you play a card and you draw a card pretty much. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to lose too much value out of that. And that's the problem, is against blue decks, sometimes you just want to lose some value out of your hand. Like when I explained that to the coaching session, it's like against Blue Duffy, you want to increase your hand size during your turn and lower it before the end of your turn, which means that whenever it's his turn, your hand size just get lower, and then when it's your turn, it gets bigger. And how to do so? Then 5-cost Luffy, Rocket Luffy, Kuzan. There is like a lot of ways to do so. Like a lot of different ways to do so.
Yeah, no, that's definitely interesting for sure. Yeah.
It's a little bit more, because when you play BY Luffy against blue decks, you play in a much more different way. You have to be a little bit more conscious. You have to respect Pudding. You have to respect Gravity Blade. So it makes your whole gameplay a little bit more tricky and funny, I would say. It's fun to play against blue decks because it's much more different.
Mm-hmm.
You have to just pay attention to those stuff.
Yeah. Let's see here. Cody says, rank each region from best to worst. I don't know if we're going to get into that one this time. But.
We're not going to get into that. it's going to be like a thread on Twitter the very next hour, and I'll be like, dude, I don't want to be part of that.
Oh, my God. Man. What's going on, Gaimon? Welcome in, Nacho. You actually think this list minus the 10 cost is the best one you've played so far. Interesting. And I think that definitely goes to like play style wise and, you know, what you encounter at like locals or stuff like that, like what Jay's talking about, because we do have the two different lists that, you know, they play very differently. And this list, the one with the Kuzan, we have Rowan here who says that against black you don't want to play your Kuzan. But actually, I think the 4-cost Kuzan is still great against black decks.
Definitely. You want to play it.
Yeah, even if it gets, let's say you're going second, right, as Black Yellow Luffy.
Yeah.
Before, with this list, you didn't really have anything that's on 4 Dawn, but this one here, Kuzan, you get to play it for 4, and you get to draw a card too, so you gain value, and they get scared of it. They use their resources earlier to try to get rid of it. Otherwise, if it sticks, then you can get rid of their Isho or their Moria a lot easier. That's how it feels for me playing black.
Yeah, like if you play Black Yellow Luffy and you have Kuzan, so in the other list there is 3 slots left, right?
Mm-hmm.
And in this list you can also play 4-cost Kuzan just for one reason. It is a good card just by itself. It is. Like, you could play Perona, which is a good 4-dawn, an extra 2K.
Yeah, Jay, good. Jay's been a Perona. He's been loving it. I still remember when I first played against your Black Yellow Luffy and what was it?
And you were playing Sakazuki.
Yeah, back in EB when I was playing Sokka and you had the Perona in there and I was like, what the fuck?
So back then, Perona was really good. I feel like Perona right now could be a little bit less good than before, but it's still a good pick. It's an extra 2K. It's not that bad. Even as a one-off, you know, you go to 11 2Ks, it's fine. Having a little bit more 2Ks in that kind of list is not that bad since we use a lot of them to just do the engine. Mm-hmm. But Kuzan overall might be better in this format just because everyone is afraid of it and you can get rid of pretty much everything. Like when you go first and you just play Kuzan at 7 dawns and you look at the Moria, at the Lucci player, and he's like, he wanted to Isho and you just play Kuzan. He's like, fuck, I cannot Isho anymore. Because if he plays Isho, then it's just dead the next turn. So now he has to play Moria and hopefully he has a Lucci in trash. And I don't know, something to reduce the cost of the Kuzan to kill it. Or he play A-cost Sabo. Mm-hmm. But that might not be the play that he wanted to do. Or it requires him to have some specific setup to just get rid of the Kuzan. Yes. And if you go second, you play it on 4 dawn, and then you just bring him back on 8 with Moria. You don't care. It's like, it's that simple.
Yep.
So it's still a good card. You can also play it in the other list with the Rush Ace. Still put a lot of value in this list as well. You have like some options for the removal, but your gameplay is not around that. Like if you don't see Kuzan, you don't see Kuzan. Whatever. You know, it's just...
Yes. And I think... And I think that's the thing, right? That like some of like what you're saying, Rowan, there is that once you're out of early game, you just cycle Sabo. And that's the thing, right? You know, the Black Yellow Luffy deck, it revolves a lot around Sabo, and that's what makes it so strong, is being able to cycle it like that. But what if you can't cycle it, right? That's where sometimes it separates the really good Black Yellow Luffy players and just the mediocre average ones who think that it's just only about cycling that Sabo. But like what you just heard from Jay right there, like if you have that 4-cost Kuzan in there, you can drop it on 7 Dawn, you know? And you start really trying to put your opponent on like that back foot there with the different kind of plays like that, instead of like just being like, okay, well, I'm just cycling Sabo like that. And if I don't cycle Sabo, well, then I just bricked it and I'm dead, you know?
And it's also a good redirect. Like, the main card of this deck is the 5-cost Luffy. And if they spend resources into Kuzan, then whenever you play the 5-cost Luffy behind that, if they don't have removal for it and it chill on the board, you're such in a good spot. I'm not gonna lie. If you play BY Luffy against Lucci, 5-cost Luffy stick to the board, you increase your win rate by 20 to 30% easily. It's just that stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Like an 8K body on board that just give the whole rhythm of the deck of the deck for BY Luffy, that just stick the board and it's covered by Sabo behind that, it's pretty much over already. I swear, it's like, how do you come back out of that? Just how do you come back out of that? You cannot get rid of it. Yeah, it's if it stick the board and everything just go as planned, then GG, go next.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, welcome in Matt. Rocks, hello. Who else? Rachel. I'm not learning BY Luffy. It's just some people asked about, you know, they wanted to get input on this new list that has Kuzan and Finger Pistol in it. And so I thought, you know, who else? You know, I got Jay a part of the community, and he's an incredible Black Yellow Luffy player who's won Treasure Cup with Black Yellow Luffy and topped in regionals. So we get his opinion. He's been testing it out for both of these. So we wanted to see his opinion on it, but it seems like he is still, while he has a little bit of testing with this version, he still leans towards the Ace variant for the time being.
I'm still in 07, so obviously I'm focused to that. So for 07, I'm leaning toward Ace. And another tech card that I really like in this list. I'm just gonna spoil it. Oh my god.
You don't have to spoil it. But here's the thing, right? If you guys want to know the full list, if you guys want to know how to really run it, you guys can sign up for coaching! coaching. All right, the link will be right there. Boom.
I already say it anyway, but it's a card that I used to run back then, and I still feel like it is in a really, really, really good spot at the moment. It is Amaru. Because it just synergized so well with Ace on top of just giving you a better ceiling for most of your card. Like, if you use Amaru and you just buff the Sabo, the blocker Sabo, I mean, he just go up to 9k, which is such a good number, you know? Just ask for 3 card, you swing with Sabo. And whenever you want to go for lethal and you have Ace into Amaru, and how many times, dude? How many times Lucci is like, I'm gonna go Rebecca into Sabo, you know? And you just look at him and you'd be like, bro, Amaru, rest the Rebecca. No, you only have one broker. What do you do? It's just that dumb. And it works on Borsalino. And I got a little screenshot for you. Let me show you.
Okay.
This is part of the PDF guide. Because no, we're just talking about Lucci. But this is the range of what Amaru can hit pretty much. Isn't it insane?
Yes, Jay has a whole PDF guide as well that talks about the ins and outs of Black Yellow Luffy, but goddamn, bro.
That's pretty much all the blockers that you might see in our current meta, and we can include also the one cost blocker low from like the blue one that can be played in Blue Duffy as well.
I wonder who runs that one cost blocker low, Jay.
Me, actually, I do, right? I wonder, Cody.
Yeah, Cody, yeah. Cody.
We've talked about it, and I do agree. This is a good card. That one cost low blocker is so good, man. Mm-hmm. Especially when you just get it back into Moria and you play it for one, and you literally just absorb two swings. Just so good, man. You don't even give any card out of your hand. But yeah, that's the range. That's every blocker that you can see in our meta. And you just rest them. Sometimes you don't want to kill them, like the two cost Shirashi against NL. You don't want to KO it. You just want to rest it, you know?
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. And honestly, that when you talk about Amaru, I've encountered Katakuris recently. Again. And it just reminded me of the card because it's like I haven't seen Amaru run, you know, in like the whole OPO7, but now that for some reason Katakuris are coming back, they're running it, and I was like, oh shit, I forgot about this card.
Yeah, I mean, why not? It's just an extra. It just makes the deck even more aggressive. Why not being aggressive when you run Ace, you know? Just might as well, you know. Just if you have some space for it, just go for it. You know, be aggressive, you know.
Oh my god.
The weakest point of the BY Luffy deck is that it's just running out of gas at some point. So you just might as well keep going fast as much as possible and hit hard, you know?
Yeah. So only relevant blockers it doesn't hit is Sabo, Hawkins, and blocker Ace if we're stretching. Oh yeah, the blue blocker Ace. Yep.
And five cost kid as well. And Queen Kid and Yeah, Okins, Sabo, Queen Kid, and Okins. Yeah, pretty much.
Yep, yep. What's going on, Mur? Talking shit. Now then, after we've talked about these decks a little bit, do you want to kind of showcase both off?
All right. So the two games will be against Blue Doffy, which is one of the most annoying matchups for BY actually, and it's getting even harder with the new starter deck. So the first game will be with the standard version of BY. So keep in mind that it was in 07, so really standard, playing just Ace, three copies of Ace, the big one and the small one. And my tech card in this decklist was Amaru, because back then Red Popolo was still here, and a lot of 4 cost or less, pretty much. A lot of blockers. Lucci players were playing a lot around Rebecca into Sabo, Rebecca Bors, and that kind of stuff. So with that standard build, since we want to be aggressive, I just wanted to play even more aggressive and just included the Amaru. And then on the next game, we'll just cover a little bit more the control approach of BY and what is going to be run in 08 pretty much as a list. And you guys can see the difference and how impactful it can be in this matchup, especially against Blue overall, especially.
All right.
So we don't have the dice roll, so he chose to go first, which is annoying for me. I like to go first against blue decks because we don't need that extra card for the draw. And I like to play the 5-cost Luffy, the starter deck Luffy, you know, the one that just helps you to take a life and swing for 8. I like to play it on curve. So on 5, I like to play it straight up. And then I play around it after that. It's going to be funny because maybe I didn't play well on those games and now I will realize it. I might have a different tech from when I played, because it was a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, you might definitely have a different take.
Yeah, so I kept this hand. I think the reason why I kept this hand is because since we're going second on for 2 dons, I'm just gonna play a baby here, because against blue decks you have to play around your hand size. You don't want to be like to have like such a big hand size, because you have to respect pudding pretty much. Obviously, Amaru is not being really helpful in this starting hand, but we have a searcher and we have Ace, which is not too bad. Here I'm just gonna play a baby, so that way I allow myself to just take the swing from Doffy. So right now the best turn for Doffy is just playing Perona. Look at the top 5, either he left it on the top or put it at the bottom. If he left it on the top, we know that the next turn we're just gonna get swing 7k to our face. So if we don't play a baby here, we're just gonna take a life, go up to 7 cards, because we're gonna have the extra draw, so 6 cards, take a life, 7 cards. Then it's our turn and we're up to 8 cards already. And from here, it's impossible to just decrease your hand size. You will always just have too much cards in your hand, pretty much. And any kind of pudding in the mid game is just gonna be hurtful pretty much. So here I like to play a baby because Blue Doffy doesn't have any kind of answer if you play a 2-cost baby. Like, literally no answer. Like, the only bottom deck that he had are Red Rock and Gravity Blade. And usually they use it on the 5-cost, not on the 2-cost. So you can just play around that a little bit.
Big brain.
So he did play Perona and he left the card on the top. You can see on the chat, he left the card on the top, which means that next turn we're going to get swing 7 and he's going to play, I don't know, probably something like Jinbei Weavile, which is the best turn for them. I don't really remember those games, but ideally they want to play Jinbei Weavile. Other than that, it's not their best turn, but it's still something. Just going to cut the sound. So he's taking a bit of time. Okay, so we draw our 6 cards. And okay, so here I'm not going to search because I don't have anything to do on 4 dons. And I'm not in a hurry. I can search next turn. So here I just want to decrease my hand size so I can take that swing and just get my life, you know, and play around my hand size. So I'm just going to play a baby, probably. Usually I play the Luffy, because Luffy is the most important card in this matchup. We'll see if I change my mind or not.
Yeah, we'll see what you... You can do the little skip, too. The little 10-second skip.
Yeah.
You can always do that.
Wait, it doesn't work? What the fuck? And I play the Sabo. Okay.
Oh.
I play the Sabo. Maybe because I have the big Sabo in hand.
Yep,
so if
yep.
If I draw Hiyori, I can just play Hiyori and play the Sabo. And he did have the Jinbei into the Weavile. So Reino, looking really good for him. Okay, so usually against blue decks, I like to go face. But in that kind of scenarios, I might just swing at his board, because otherwise it's going to be really complicated. Like, the problem with going second is that we are putting less pressure, and we, with that list, we don't have any good turns on four dons or in the very early. So at the moment, it's too early to, you know, start just something, pretty much. And with our current hand, we can't do much, to be fair. I might just go into the board at this point. Okay, we got a 5-cost Luffy, which is nice. Maybe I should have taken the Rocket as well here, because he's going to swing at us for sure. And we're going down to 2 life, and Rocket can just KO pretty much everything that Duffy is going to play. But 5-cost Luffy is still the key. So we might be able to see another Rocket Luffy, to be fair. There is 4 in the deck, so... Okay. So here I just swing 8 at the Jinbei, just to reduce a little bit the pressure and make sure I do not get put in. Because this hand is not horrible. Could be better, but it's fine.
Mm-hmm.
So now he plays Moria, which means that he's not going to swing at us. If he does that, he's not going to swing at us. So he's probably afraid of swinging at us, which is understandable. A lot of people still do not understand how to swing at BY. So it's fine. We take those, which that gives us a little bit more time to just, you know, do what we have to do, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
So if he doesn't swing at us, our next turn is just probably going to play the 5-cost Luffy, but we're not going to use his ability.
Okay.
Oh, he does swing at us. Okay. So we take.
Pop one, thanks so much for the 6-7 months.
Sure. Yeah, we give the Sabo, yeah.
Going on, dude.
Okay. So now we're down to 2 life. So here, the reason why we do not use the 5-cost Luffy ability is, so right now we're on 2 life, so we're not going to use the ability for sure. And you don't want to keep your hand size too big. So right now, how many cards do we have? We have 8 cards,
mm-hmm.
which is still a lot. Usually I attempt to go up to 7 maximum. I don't want to go above 7, because if you use pudding, you have 7 in hand. It's the same as if he was swinging 7 to you, pretty much. You lose 2 cards. Mm-hmm. So it's okay. It's like, it's okay. But when you go up to 8, then it's kind of hurtful. And especially right now, because we have Moria in hand. We have some 5-cost in trash. We have some babies. We can start to, you know, plan a little bit our next turns. So we're just going to play the 5-cost Luffy and not use the ability. So we just lose 1 card from our hand. We stay at 7 and we see how that goes from here. And I will probably swing 6 at the Weavile because he played 4-cost Moria. That just gave me a hint that his hand might not be that crazy. Like, there is better plays to do for sure. And he didn't do it, which means that he might not have everything that he needs. So we'll see. We're just going to swing at his board and try to go after his hand. He only has 5 in hand. So we can try to go after his hand.
Okay. Yeah, what's going on? Jiving as well. It's cool meeting you in Dallas. Always, dude. Always a great time seeing you, man. I hope you had a good time.
Yeah. But usually, if we're going first from here, I always go face, because I know I will start everything around 7 dons and then we keep pressuring them, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
But when we're going second, I feel a little bit less comfortable, sadly. So the beginning is really slow. Like So the worst for us at the moment would be Gravity Blade or Red Rock onto the Luffy. Like, we don't want that Luffy. We don't want him to get rid of that Luffy, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so he's doing five at us, so we have to counter this. Obviously, because... Okay, I did not counter.
He said, obviously, we have to counter.
I did not counter that. So we have to counter this one just because Pudding can still be deadly from here. I don't know. Should have not taken that one. So right now I'm gonna counter this one for sure.
always funny to see what watch VODs and see what you end up doing.
Yeah, exactly. What was in my head back then? And I think when I did those games, it was really early in the morning as well. So I might just have woke up when I did those games.
Back to ask you all Nami BY Luffy game, bro.
Okay, and see, we can see
I
here
so bad.
Him swinging five and five and not playing that fast. Just confirm my my feeling of him not having the tools that he won right now, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And he red worked the Luffy, which is annoying. But we have how many dons? We are 9? 8? Okay, we are 8 dons right now. Which means that at the moment, we have a Sabo in the trash. And I'm going to start the engine, pretty much, with Flampy. Mm-hmm. Oh, I need to tell you something about later. So I'm gonna start the engine, mm-hmm. and I will probably stay as a 7k leader with one life, because I know that my next turn is gonna be Moria, so my leader can be as a 9k leader and one life, and I can just loop it up pretty much, mm-hmm, after mm-hmm. that. So I have to spend at least one turn as a 7k leader, and right now it's the perfect moment. He doesn't have anything on board, just a Moria, his leader, and two Peronas. So
yeah,
this is probably the best play. And we got a baby ace on top of that, which is perfect. And the Rocket Luffy. Since we didn't get it earlier, no, we have it. So it's good. And you will understand how good is Rocket Luffy, because you can get a lot of value out of that.
Yeah, I hate it. I hate it when they do 9k leader, one extra life, and it's Rocket Luffy Sabo.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's freaking so annoying.
It's just shit ton of value. It's
yeah.
It never ends. So right now in my trash, I have baby Luffy and big Sabo. So I would probably trash an ace here, I guess, just to play down either ace or Sabo, one of those. But I have the way how I spread my dons here, I think I was like, okay, 4 dons is just to use one baby pretty much. So I already knew that I was going to just use one baby. So 2 under my leader and 2 for one baby. Then I have 3 extra dons. And I was wondering, what should I do with those 3 extra dons? Should I just play ace, swing big as his leader, and see how that goes? But he still has 5 in hand, right? And from what we saw, doesn't look like his hand is that good, right? So I think here, I would just swing 5 with Garp at the Moria and see how he reacts. Because if he defended, then we can just play ace, go 7 into the Moria, and 7 lead. So he still loses a life. And we still play a body. If he doesn't defend it, then we go just double 7 to his face, which is good because we were a little bit slow and we are catching up a little bit, you know. So we'll see. And I do swing 5 with Garp, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So
let's see if he lets it go.
If he lets it go, that's the best scenario for us. Because we can just go face and we just catch up all the, like, we were so late, right? And now we're just catching up so fast because the next turn is Moria, which means we can play another ace as well with that Moria, because we will have the baby in the trash pretty much. And if I did play well, the next turn is gonna be nasty. Okay, we'll see. Okay, so I do go for the ace play here, which makes sense. And keep in mind, we still have our baby Sabo on board, right? He's been there since turn 1.
Yep.
And you're going to understand why that baby is good right now, pretty much. If he doesn't use Gravity Blade onto the baby and the ace, you will get it why it was good.
And if he does Gravity Blade it,
then it's a little bit annoying, but we have Garp, which means that we can find more answers.
Okay. Yeah, we'll see what the thing is that doing here.
Here, if he Gravity Blade, he doesn't play down anything. Mm-hmm. Like, he doesn't play anything on board, which means he's not pressuring us anyway next turn. So we can be stuck for a turn, which could be fine, right? But he cannot kill us the next turn anyway, so because he won't be able to play any kind of body.
Mm-hmm.
7 dawns, he's on 9, only 2 dawns left. He can do shit.
Can't do
so
shit.
So his best player here would be playing Boa, I guess, or some kind of blockers, and like, you know, going wide on the board. Like, he has Jinbe in hand. We've seen him getting the Jinbe back from the trash through the Moria. So playing Jinbe and a blocker would be ideal here, or the 6-cost Boa, pretty much. Okay, he played Jinbe, okay, into a Weavile. So he's getting wide on the board for sure. Okay, let's see. Anything 7 at the ace. Okay, so here, we're going to defend that ace for sure, because we have a lot of pressure going on. And he didn't use the leader ability, which means he's going to play the 3-cost Doflamingo with the 3 mm-hmm. remaining dons.
Yep, yep, yep.
And us defending that ace is just the beginning of the snowball effect, pretty much, because we're going to put that Rocket Luffy in trash. And then after that, we're just going to get so aggressive, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And you will understand in a bit. Because that Moria, pretty much, is not going to play 2 bodies, like 2 5-cost body, but like 3, it could play 3 5-cost bodies. Because we kept that baby Sabo on board, which means that this Moria, we're going to just go wide on the board. Like, play Ace into Rocket into Sabo. We mm-hmm. KO the Doffy, and we keep going face. And leader is a 9k. We have a blocker. And we have 2 5-cost Moria. So now, if you want a Gravity Blade, one more time, he doesn't pressure us. Cost 7 dons. He doesn't do anything after that. He has to play another blocker.
Mm-hmm.
So if I did play well here, I'm just playing Moria into Ace into Luffy, KO the Doffy, and then face. And then from here, it's just the aggressive play. And that's why Ace is so good in this matchup. Against Blue overall, against Nami, against Boa, it's just really good. So now we do play the baby Sabo. Oh, and I even swing with
it. Yeah, swing, little cheeky swing first, yo. Yeah.
And I trash the ace because I'm just going to get it back.
Yep.
And I think we're going to trash an Amaru. Yeah, we don't need 2 Amaru.
Terp Town, what's going on, Jordan?
So now we have Ace, a blocker. We're going to play Moria, and we're going to play 2 more 5-cost, which is insane.
Mm-hmm. We'll see if you do the Rocket Luffy and Ace.
Yeah, I should use Moria first here just to kill the Doffy.
Moria first before Sabo, you're saying? Or before swing? Yeah, you'd want to do it before swinging. Yeah, before swinging.
Usually you swing first, so you play around triggers, right? That mm-hmm. Gravity Blade, most likely. But here we have to kill the blocker and make sure we get the best value out of our swings. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you so much for the 37 months.
Here I'm going to probably crush 3 bones because we have Garp in hand anyway. Okay, so I do play the Rocket. We KO the Doffy. And then we go 7 phase.
Mm-hmm.
How many cards do we have? We have 6 in hand.
Oh, yeah, I got to text you, Jordan.
2 2Ks.
Got to text you about those slabs.
3 1Ks. 11, 13, 14. 15, 16. Okay, so here I should not use the Ace ability, because if he has the Perfume Femur, the event, if you put it under Weavile, he can swing 16. Oh no, we could be a 11k leader. So 13, 15. Yeah, I should play ace here and keep getting even more aggressive because did he defend? Oh yeah, he gave us a lot of 1k. So here's a mistake. It's a misplay here. When I swing this, that 7 with ace, he gave us a bunch of 1k.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you smell right, the hand.
Exactly. So right now we know that there is no 2Ks, right? Our leader is a 9K base, and we should play the ace here just because we know there is no 2Ks.
Yep.
Then if we do so, we end up at zero life, which is fine, even though he used the perfume, because with perfume, he can only swing 16K at our leader. And since we are based 11K, if we use another baby, the base stat is going to be 11K. We have two 2Ks and three 1K. So we can survive on a 16K swing pretty much. So I should have played the ace here and put him down to one life. Because the next turn, if he plays Kaido, it could be a good turn for him to just, you know, come back.
And there
he,
we are.
He do play Kaido. So I could get punished here for that. But if he plays Kaido, keep in mind one thing. He's looking for answers. He's looking for counters. And he doesn't swing at you, which means you keep your whole board. And he doesn't do any kind of removal. So you can keep pressuring him. And that's what I do. 7, straight up.
Yep. And even though he draws 4 from Kaido, he's about to lose more than 4 cards here.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Like right now, with our current hand, I don't see how Doffy can win. We have 3 2Ks. We have some babies to keep to maintain our leader as a 9K leader. And our board is just crazy, pretty much. Okay.
So, why don't you want to try and smell out his hand some more and swing with the ace first?
I don't know right now. It's like, I don't know what I was thinking. I should have just... How many dons left? 6, 7? 7 dons left? I got another ace, okay. So I might pressure him even harder, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I was looking for, maybe. I was looking for another ace. Since we didn't see any other cards, the odds of us finding another ace were pretty decent, I guess. There is 3 in the deck, by the way. So, I swing 9. I'm not sure here. Swinging 9, I'm not sure if it's the right thing to do, because if we play another ace, we could have swing 9 with that other ace. So here I should have swing 7 first.
Mm-hmm.
And not
smell
9.
That hand. So, yeah, swing 7.
Yeah, because here it's a little bit too big as a swing, because we're going to swing like... do some smaller swing after that. But he did defend it. So it's kind of helpful for us right now to do the math, because he only had 3 in hands. So we know that he can only survive a 9K swing now. And he needs 2 2Ks and a 1K to do so. And I do go aggressive and go with that ace. Oh, I'm wondering if I should use Amaru right now or not. And Amaru could be nice here, because we could use it on Sabo, swing 9 with Sabo. It just help you to have better ceiling, to be fair. So here he's for sure dead. It's just that I think I'm trying to figure it out how I can do it in the most efficient way. Because we could also not swing with Sabo just in case we don't kill him. Mm-hmm. But if I do the math right, he should be dead. Cause like if I swing 9 here and then 9, if he defend, then we do 7, 9, 11, he's dead. Mm-hmm. And then if I do, I don't know. Yeah, I think I should do that here. 9 with Sabo. Then if he defend, we do 7, 9, 11. If he does not, then we go 9 again. Then 7. Okay, I'm not... Okay, that's 10? Not good. Yeah. Yeah, so the math here are not good. But it might be because I wanted to keep the Sabo. Because I'm not dying the next turn anyway. That's the thing.
10.
Then, yeah, we go 10 again, I guess. Yeah.
And then 11. 9?
What the fuck?
10, 9, 11, or 10, dude. 9, 12?
Okay, so my math here, they were wrong as hell. I mean, I could do 7 with Sabo at the end. Oh, yeah, I mean, we still had lethal, because if you do 11...
You go 7 with Sabo, yeah.
Yeah, he gives you 4 cards at best, and then 7 with Sabo. So it was still all right, but I don't think it was the most optimal way here.
Okay, okay. There's some different play lines.
Yeah, it's funny, because now I have a different take on that video, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that was the first game, and you can definitely see how Ace is so strong against Blue Doffy.
Yep.
And if we go back a bit, you can see that I've never played with more than 8 cards during Doffy's turn. So if I go up to 8 cards, it would be during my turn, and then I go down and then pass, then go up, go down, and pass, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I first put my leader as a 9k leader, I had a lot of cards, right? I had,
yes,
I don't know, 9, 10, 3, 6, 9 cards. Yeah. And then because I play Ace, I do minus 2, and we go back to 7. But I have to trash one, so we go back to 6. So now we are not even in range of pudding anymore. And see, at the end, I think he had pudding in hand. See?
Yep.
He had pudding, and he had perfume femur.
Yep.
Never be able to use the pudding, never be able to use the perfume.
Yeah.
He didn't see the gravity blade, but at least we played around it as long as possible, and Team Moria just helped us to go wide on board, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And this is how I approach my matchup against Blue Doffy, is that usually I just put myself as a 7k leader, and I keep looping it through Rocket Luffy, so I just get rid of his whole board, because most of his characters cost 4 or less, so you're gonna KO something every time. This is where Rocket Luffy has the best value. It's against blue decks, usually. Because you KO for sure, and you draw. And then after that, Moria comes in, and then you can go wide and keep pressuring them even harder. Because if they want to get rid of Moria, Red Rock, 6 downs. If they want to be a little bit annoying and play Boa, 6 downs. If they want to get rid of the 5 cost, 7 downs. And they can't do anything with the rest of the downs, pretty much, because their body do not swing that high. So the scariest part against Blue Doffy is most likely the mid game. You just wanna do the engine in the most efficient way possible. And it is tough because you cannot have a big hand size, and you have to play around pudding and gravity blade. And you have to analyze those key moments. Sometimes you want them to pudding you, because your hand is just so bad that even if you lose 3 cards out of your hand, the next 5 cards that you're going to get just going to put you in a better spot than the 8 cards that you had in hand.
Yep,
and that's how you can play around pudding. Like if you judge that your hand is really bad, just take the life. Take the swings. Just do not defend. Do not play around pudding. Take everything and then let him pudding you. And then you can have a fresh start and see how it goes from here.
Okay. So yeah, for those that are curious, this is the No Kuzan list. So
No Kuzan. It's really like standard build. Everything is time 4 except for Ace, which is a time 3, baby and the big one. And my tech card in this decklist was Amaru, because as I said, it was 07, Red Popolo was still here, a lot of 4 cost and less. The chopper blocker onto Reiju, all of the 4 cost or less onto the Red Popolo, Borsalino, Rebecca. So many. Okay. Now we're going to see another game against Blue Doffy, but this time with the control version.
Yep.
And you guys will see that I'm going to struggle a lot. And keep in mind that back then, I didn't have too much experience with that list, because you play it in a much more different way than this list, for sure.
Wet Potato, you better remember me when you saw that uncut sheet, man. Doffy coaching
Did
when?
Close it? Does it close the stream?
It's a... Yeah, okay. Okay, that's fine.
Let me start it again.
Going on, Laz? Lazies?
Do we see the list?
Lazies.
Okay, we see the list on this one. Okay, that's good.
Yeah, how come Jay doesn't have an Australian axe?
I live with the kangaroos, man. Yeah, that's what I wanted to tell you.
Oh, yeah.
To tell you. You were making fun of me every time I was saying engine. And, you know, I was in holidays, like, for the last the last week.
Uh-huh.
And I went to visit my friends in the Netherlands. And he fucking teach me that we don't say engine, but engine. And I was like, that's why he's making fun of me. Fuck me.
So what, are you telling me you're going to pronounce it differently now?
No, I'm still going to say the engine.
Yeah, the engine.
The engine.
Oh, man.
God damn it. Okay, let's move a little bit. Okay, whoa, whoa, whoa. Okay.
Oh, wait. Hold on. Oh, okay. I see it now.
Okay, you can see it?
Yes, yeah, I can see your stream now.
Okay, so here, we are going first, but we didn't choose. He chose to go second, which I do like personally. Like even when I did the training session with Cody, anytime I can go first, I go first. And then after that, we switch it up pretty much. But I like to go first. It's just my preference here. And the thing is with that list, with the control list, since we're playing Kuzan, we don't lose any card advantage, right? Yep. That's the whole point of this list. And it is so bad against Blue Doffy because sometimes you do want to lose some card advantage, right? Like we play the baby, we play, you know. And with Kuzan, it's a good four dons turn, but you don't lose anything. So it's really annoying. And on top of that, it's so useless against Blue Doffy. Like at best, you kill what? You kill the Boa at best. But if he plays Boa and he uses it on Kuzan, you cannot even swing with Kuzan, which means that you could potentially like get rid of the Boa through Kuzan, but not even guaranteed. He could just use Gravity Blade the very next turn on it. So I don't really like Kuzan against Blue Doffy. And I think I will probably mulligan this hand.
Yeah. And then there's probably no time for you to play Tenzan, right? In this matchup?
Yeah. No, yeah. There is no way. Because they swing at you. Like if they know how to play, they will swing at you. Holy. Okay, I do remember a little bit this game. This game was horrible. Okay, so we're going to have a really tough hand. But at least we have the Luffy. We have the Luffy.
True.
That is the good thing. We have Hiyori and Luffy. They are the only two good scouts at the moment. And Moria will be good, but later on.
Mm-hmm. What's going on, Croutons?
We don't like it in this matchup. Tenkos Kuzan, you will never have the window to play it.
What happened?
Well. And
the stream. Okay, we're back. The stream went
okay,
funky.
We're back?
Yeah, we're back.
Okay, so he plays Perona, which means... So here it's a little bit different because Doffy is going second. He could swing 8 at us and, you know, do the same thing that he did earlier. But since he's going second, he could also just play the cards on curve, you know. He could just play Jinbe for 4, get a Weavile, and swing 5 at us. And then he can set up a little bit the cards on top of his deck differently. And he did play the cards on top of his deck. You can see it in the chat.
Yep.
So now it's a little bit different. If he swing 8, you have to take it anyway. If he swing 5, you might want to defend it.
To keep your hand size lower.
Yeah, but here we don't have anything. We don't want to give the Yuri or the Luffy. Uh-huh. So either he swing 5 or 8, we're just going to take it.
Okay. But yeah, what Depending potato says what he wants to play Doffy in the no, what potato? No, there's gonna be so many people playing Doffy in 8.5 and 9.
Yeah, Doffy is good, it's hella good, but you gotta have to wait for the new starter deck. Even right now, it's still okay, it's still doing well, right? But
yeah,
it still lose really badly into the Lucci matchup. So
don't go to the dark side, wet potato. Jay makes you want to play BY Luffy the way that he explains stuff, bro. For real, it's crazy, man. I swear, Jay, if you explain something to somebody, you could probably get them to do anything, man.
You think so?
I think so, dude. Like,
am I good at explaining? Like, people
like your voice, I guess, is the main thing, you know?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's like good. You tell voice and like the accent, I guess.
I'm happy to hear that then.
Yeah, like you tell a girl like, oh, take off her panties, it's probably boom, instant.
Oh man. Okay, so we did draw Rocket Luffy here, which means that we could use that Rocket Luffy to counter the 5k swing. So we have a little bit of we can play around our hand size. Mm-hmm. And see, he wanted to swing five because he wanted to play his stuff on curve. Mm-hmm. But he's like, should I use my leader ability? So the card that he put on top is probably either something that he can play on his ability or something that he wanna draw and play later on. So probably a card that gives him some value. And he did play Jinbei into Weavile on curve. So no, the next step should be swinging five at Earth, but he should have done it earlier, because if he swing five right now and we take trigger Rocket Luffy KO Weavile, yep, he's in such a bad spot.
Yep.
Okay, he doesn't swing. Okay, that's fair. Well, we're going to swing for sure because we're going first, so we're going to get hella aggressive. He defend, which is obvious, and we're just going to play Luffy. And here, one more time, we do not use the ability because we keep the hand size low. Mm-hmm. We just don't want to go. We're already on 6. So if he invests 1 down onto Weavile, we go up to 7. It's already annoying, right? He could pudding right after that. But
yeah,
that's the hand right now that we have right now. If we get pudding, we don't care, to be fair. We don't care. Like, there is like half of the hand, we're not going to use it before a long time.
So was it a good thing that he didn't swing into you there for 5? Because that would have, I mean, it would have made your hand size bigger, but then you also say like it doesn't matter if you get pudding, right? So
yeah, but he doesn't know that I don't mind getting pudding, right? That's the thing. Mm-hmm. Like the most convenient way for him will be to swing, because he's getting wide on board and he just want to pressure me down before I'm getting at ease. If yep. he doesn't pressure me down and put me in a tough spot before the Morias and stuff like that, you know, he's going to be in a tough spot. And especially if he has pudding in hand, why would you not swing?
Yeah, like, so maybe it's life, a sign that he doesn't have pudding.
It could be, you know. But people play differently. They have different kind of game plan, you know. Like Koti, whenever he used pudding on me, he knows how to use the pudding properly. And sometimes he puddings me when I have like 6 or 5 in hand. Because he knows with those 5 or 6 in hand, he can just lose the game. He knows that those 6 cards right now in my hand, he can feel it, that they are deadly for him.
Yeah.
So depending on the player you're going to face, some of those will analyze much more better than other and understand your game plan much more better than other. And you can just lose because of that, because it's not up to you.
Crazy.
It at the moment it's hard to tell right now. Like if he's like if he doesn't swing because he doesn't know how to swing at BY, or if he doesn't swing for other reasons, right?
Mm-hmm. Let me say that.
So now we're just gonna take our life and we're just gonna do what we have to do, right? But see, here's the thing, he didn't swing. We use the Luffy's ability and our hand size just go so big right now.
Mm-hmm.
And there is no coming back. We don't have any babies. We only have 4 cost Kuzan, which make us draw pretty much. So this is terrible at the moment. Like, we're in a rough spot for sure. We have nothing to play. We just want to swing. We cannot even use Rocket onto anything at the moment. So it's tough. It's definitely a tough spot.
Smoker, alt-art leader, top 3 in the game, dude.
And I'm taking a bit of time to think about what I'm going to do. So I swing 8. I don't know. Here, looking at my hand, I would probably just swing 8 with my leader and play 4 cost Kuzan. That's probably it.
Yep. It looks yeah. like you're doing that.
Yeah. There you go. There you go. Yeah, because... And he takes them. And right now, it's really weird because he's going down to 2. If just imagine right now if I was playing the odd list with Ace.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going first. I would have go hella aggressive, to be fair.
Another and 10 crop Kuzan.
It keep getting worse and worse. It's just insane.
Yeah, you'd just be jamming him at this point with the ace in the other list.
Yeah, exactly. So you can already see like the difference. And we got G-Blade, okay? We got G-Blade and boom, we got punished. So with the other list, I would not play more than 1 character. I would just keep 5 cost Luffy, use Rocket, KO Weavile. Boom. Only 5 cost Luffy stay on the board. Leader is a 7k base, and we keep swinging 9 with Luffy, 9 with leader, 9 with Luffy, 9 with leader, by just keeping 1 character.
Mm.
And we go wide only when Moria comes out. But with this list, it's harder to do so. And if I was playing the old list, I would do Rocket, kill Weavile. Next turn, Rocket, kill the Vanilla Moria. Lower his pressure. Do not give him anything to just pressure you down, pretty much. And you can just keep moving forward onto your deck and your life. And then play Moria, pretty much. You just slam it after that.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, we cannot. So we have to play Kuzan. Then he used G-Blade. We lose the Luffy. We lose Moria, Kuzan. So we don't have anything left, pretty much. Okay, and now he swings at us, which is so weird to me, Wayne. Like, after just getting rid of everything, he's just swinging at us. So I don't get it. So we're still at 2 life. Looking at our hand, we only have the 5-cost Luffy to play. But this is not the good play at the moment. Because he has 4 characters to swing at us. Like, I mean, 3 and the leader. And potentially the Peronas, right?
Mm-hmm.
So right now, we could be dead for sure. And if we are not dead, he can just use Pudding. Because we have 10 in hand. It's insane, right? So here, this is definitely a bad spot. And to be fair, I think this game should be lost straight up at this very like moment. So playing 5-cost Luffy, not an option anymore. Here, we have to play... I don't fucking know. We have like, what, 9 down? Playing Moria is not even thinkable because we're dying anyway. So we have to do some kind of removal. So I think here we're going to just do Rocket into Shigan and kill the 2 Vanillas. So that way he cannot kill us pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what I'm going to do. I mean, from what I see, it's pretty much the best play. Because we're down to 2 life. If we kill 2 of the 6k characters, then he won't be able to kill us. We have too many 2ks in hand. And
Chat was asking, so earlier you were talking about, like, in that earlier situation, you would have done Rocket Luffy, kill the Weevil, swing 8 with the Luffy and swing whatever with your leader, right? But then how do you Rocket when you're at 3 life?
You use Hiyori. You use Hiyori, you take a life, you put the Rocket. You use the baby, and then the next life is the Rocket. You go down to 2 and you kill. And with that list, so I think in this list, I was running less searchers, which means that it gives me less options to find the pieces that I want. And we're going to get through the deck list after the video. And I will show you pretty much like a good standard list for OPO8 right now. And the fact that we do not run 8 searchers in this list is what is the reason why we're losing the game. Because just imagine if we, instead of that 10-cost Kuzan, we just have 1 searcher. We get a baby. We play Hiyori. Leader is a 7k. Boom, boom, boom. Everything just starts to move on pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And because we do not run that many searchers, we are not finding the pieces. And if you're not finding the pieces, you just lose.
Mm. I got you, Carl.
So right now, I have to find some kind of way to survive. And the best things to do here is just to do removals. Like, I have to do Rocket into Shigan. That's the only play.
I have to find the right times to ask the question, you know? To not talk over
that's
him.
That's so sad, because he's down to 2 life. We could be so much more aggressive with Ace and stuff like that.
Did you see the list from, like, you know, the top players from NA this weekend?
Oh, yeah. Jackson sent me a message on Twitter right before the event. So he asked me what I was thinking about his list and stuff like that. and it was funny. It was funny. A lot of things that we were talking about. We can talk a little bit after the video.
Yeah.
Because it's going to be funny. So I did end up just doing some removal. And one more time, we do not lose any hand. Our hand size just do not, like, reduce, right? It's just so bad, because we can get Pudding at any moment and be in such a tough spot, but we still have 2 life, so we're managing so far.
5k leader, 2 life, not terrible,
because even if we get Pudding, we still have the 2 cards from our life, the next draws, and Rhino, this is where it gets terrible, because he plays Kaido, and from here it's just straight up lose. Because imagine if the next turn he plays Kaido again.
That's
like
gonna be rough.
The odds of him drawing a Kaido, they are not too bad right now. Drawing four cards is insane. And we have nothing to pressure him this turn. I mean, the very next turn. So there is no reason for him to not play another Kaido, right?
Yep.
Why not? And I don't know. He's probably not going to swing at us here. Maybe because he probably drew pudding. So he'll be like, it's fine. I'm going to pudding next turn. Not going to swing. Not going to let him just give me some 1K counter, you know? Would make sense here to not swing. We'll see.
So we have someone in chat that says, I thought it was better for Doffy to starve against BY Luffy early on to force the Luffy player to take their own life and pressure a pudding play.
No, because if you want to pressure him down, like if you want to do that kind of play and the BY know how to play, you have to swing big then. And if you swing big, you don't play any characters or you play at least one through your leader ability. And if you're lucky, two, if you got Jinbei. But other than that, if you swing fire, I would just defend. And sometimes if we swing six, I would just give you a 2K because I don't care. It's just, I understand what are my losing condition. And this is one of my losing conditions. So I will play around for sure. It's like, there is nothing wrong about countering. Like people are used to see BY Luffy just taking their life and be like, oh, I'm going to do the engine, right? It's like, it's not always like that. And the blue color is one of those funny color where the matchup is literally the opposite of what you usually do. Like when I play against Voodoo, if I have 12 in hand, he already lose the game because he's playing Lucci. There is no recovery bond, right? No recovery. He can play three, sure, he will still lose the game, right? That is just that bad because I have too much resources. But if I play against Blue, I cannot allow myself to do that. So I have to play in a much more tricky way and understand that I need to play like a standard leader a little bit, like counter some of the 5K swings because those 5K swings could just literally make me lose the game at some point.
Has Jay played and a lot against a lot of purple Luffies lately?
Pluffy? No, I haven't faced too many. The few ones that I faced in ranked, I think I won, but it wasn't like super easy, you know, it was still like a... I think it's still slightly favorable for BY, but it you could lose for sure. So here he's swinging.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, I will defend for sure because I don't know if he drew the pudding out of the Kaido. So I have to defend that.
Yeah.
Because next turn, if I get pudding and I have like fucking, I don't know, 12 in hand, I'm just dead. I'm just so dead. So I'm just going to give him the 5-cost Luffy because it's too late for me to play the 5-cost Luffy.
Mm-hmm.
And we got, our hand is just getting worse and worse. And the fact that I already like rested my leader to swing just mean one thing. I'm just going to slam down the Tenkas Kuzan. And I'm just going to hope that he's going to stick the board. That's my only play at the moment. So, and for sure he defend. Well, we still kill it. And Rhino, if he doesn't play another Kaido and if our Kuzan stick the board.
You do another Kuzan? Yeah.
Exactly. We do another Kuzan and we kill the Kaido and we're in a good spot. Then we back to the game. But if he got Red Rock, then I don't know. To be fair, to me, this game should have... It's already lose. It's been two turns, even three turns, to be fair.
Yeah, because you've been a 5K
and now
leader.
He swings six.
Yeah.
He swings six. And see, I give a 2K. I don't care. Uh-huh. I need to give the 2K here. And no, we take, yeah.
Like,
sure.
I feel like he could have just jammed, he could have jammed you harder this turn, no?
Yeah, but no, because he has, like, right now, like, I just paused it. Can you guess what he's gonna do? He literally played 3-cost Luffy. Look at his Don and just guess.
He's got 6 Don remaining. I wonder what he could be doing with that 6 Don right there, you guys.
So, at that very moment, I don't exactly remember, but me 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago, being in that position, I should be like, fuck, the Red Rock is coming. I should be crying right now. I must be crying because I know the Kuzan is not going to stick the board, sadly. And and look, our hand keeps getting worse and worse. It's just insane. We just keep drawing 2K over 2Ks. Literally no 5 costs, no babies. So what do we do from here? It's just tough, right?
Yeah.
Like we have baby Sabo, we have no Sabo at all. How the fuck am I gonna win this game?
We'll see, because I think you do win this game.
Do I? I don't know.
I think you win this game. I think that's why you uploaded it.
I mean, I could upload some losing videos as well. I don't mind losing.
Yeah, maybe.
When you rewatch them, then it's a good learning process.
Maybe you're trying to spread the propaganda of this deck list being shit.
It's not bad, to be fair. It's just really different than how you used to play BY. And in this kind of deck list, you might often play Moria before starting your engine right now.
Yeah.
Like on 4 you play Kuzan get KO. On 8 you play Moria, you play back Kuzan. Boom. Mm-hmm. You play Moria on 8. Usually you never do that with the old list. You just start the engine and use Moria to sustain your leader as a 9k without losing too many resources.
Mm-hmm.
So it is a very different approach, for sure. Okay, we got a baby Luffy, and just for you guys to understand, Luffy is the best card against blue matchups, and the reason why things start to get better from now is only because I drew that baby Luffy, and you will understand like the snowball effect of that Luffy pretty much.
Play less 2k? You think he should play less 2ks so that he could play more searchers?
Maybe.
Oh,
what did we draw? We're getting another baby.
You hate it when channels only upload wins? Is that Mr. Voodoo's channel? is that what it is?
So here, obviously, if I had a 5-cost Sabo, that would be awesome to play 5-cost Sabo on 5.
That would. That would be amazing.
But we don't have any. Okay. Let's see what he does. He takes the life.
Kuzan, yep.
Oh, what do we get here? We finally get a 5-cost Sabo. Okay. The reason why I did not swing big at the Kaido here is because I knew he could defend it, because my swing wouldn't be that big, to be fair.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And look at our hand. We have fucking 5 2Ks, right? We have 5 2Ks. I want him to just try to go for game, right? I just want him to try to go for game, because that means he's not doing anything. And because I have Moria, I can come back through that positioning, because he's not doing anything else if he tried to go for game.
Yeah, do you think, I mean, for the Dofi perspective, you think if you played pudding here and try to go for a game is, oh, okay.
There you go.
There we go. Yeah, pudding, okay. And then trying to, interesting.
So what goes, do I do here?
He goes 12 first. Oh. And
this is what I don't get.
Oh, what the heck? That's why he went.
I would have just swing so big. Yeah. At me, right?
That's why he went 12 six first. Downs left. Yeah.
But I was a 7k leader, so I could go 9, 10, 11, but I couldn't survive, right? He was swinging 11 at me.
Yeah, because he could have done 11, 12 too.
Exactly. That would have been dead. But guess what? Sometimes people do not go for it, you know? We take those. Okay, but no, we don't have Moria anymore, which is bad.
So you got to find a way back in the game.
Exactly. But we have searchers. And that is also one of the reasons why we should run 8 searchers. Because if you get pudding, even though you don't get the babies or the 5-cost, then you're going to get searchers. And guess what? Searchers give you all of those. So you will always find a way to just bounce back, even after the pudding. And we got a Sabo. Boom. Now we have a blocker. We can survive. Hallelujah.
Yeah, you trash the finger pistol, maybe?
Yeah, I was thinking, but I think from this point I should trash the finger pistol, because I need counters and I need to find a way to survive and win.
But I guess you could cycle the finger pistol out with Sabo too.
Yeah. But I don't have the baby Sabo, I cannot. But I could play the Sabo row. And this is what I'm going to do, pretty much.
Yeah, so you end up playing Sabo for 5 more.
Yeah.
You've seen me lose before.
So
he defends.
So now he's down to 4 in hand. Which makes it even more easier for us to do the math whenever we want to go for game. And here you can see why it was so bad for Doffy to just go down to 2 life so fast.
Yeah, because, I mean, even with the Kaido, they had a bunch of cards in hand earlier. Now it's just down to 4, and they're down to 1 life, and they're in a situation where they could die.
And nothing really changed, right? Like, we were in such a bad spot. But see, the hand that he literally just put back at the bottom, like that we just get pudding,
mm-hmm.
we managed to just get 5 new cards, and because of 1 card, everything just start to move on a little bit again.
Yes.
We have 2-2 case.
Because of one search.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And same with the Luffy. At the end, before we get we got pudding, that Luffy make us draw a card, that make us draw a card, and we play Kuzan that make us draw a card, and it's just, sometimes it just unlocks so many things, and this is a reason why Luffy is just the best card onto the blue matchups overall. Because first of all, he's not a target for the 6-cost Boa. So whenever they slam down Boa, then Luffy can still swing. He can just do some removal as a rocket. You can elevate yourself as a 7k leader and just make sure you get some value out of that, because they cannot swing at you, or they have to invest resources to do so. But that means that they have less resources to play some characters or use some events. And as you can see during those games, using Red Rock, using Gravity Blade, just costs so much for them, right? It just costs so much. They don't do anything after that.
We have someone that says that, but the only way you continue to survive is because every turn this Doffy does a lot of mistakes.
It is true. But do you think in tournaments you're just going to play against crazy player every turn?
And I think it's also because we don't know what currently is in their hand as well. They don't know what's in our hand. So you have to see that Doffy player wanted to play it safer that one turn, playing the Red Rock instead of swinging 11. You know, there's no way that the player can know for sure how many counter Jay has in hand.
As I said earlier, this game was lost already after 3 turns, looking at my hand. I knew it was lost, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that I just managed to win this game, it might be luck. It might be because the Doffy player did a lot of mistakes and stuff like that. But it happened, you know. It just happened. And in tournament, it's going to be the same. Like, even when you're going to go to top 32, you're just going to play against people who are just going to make mistakes. And most of the time, whenever you beat someone in tournament, it's because they made a mistake. Sometimes it's a small one, sometimes it's a big one. And sometimes you also win because you got a bit more success and a little bit more lucky as well. You've seen everything that you needed without spending too much resources for that.
Nice. And Ox. Nice, nice.
So the fact that I managed to win that game is a scam, for sure. It is a scam, for sure, right? But we managed to get through it, so...
Oh, man. Yeah, you don't expect every game to be linear. In tournaments, on your personal experience, these guys only inside events you can meet. This is local level. Oh, man.
I mean, trust me, I've seen people run 9 when we were both X1 or XO not playing that great, you know?
Yeah, I've...
There is no judging from it. It's just like, maybe they had a bad hand. Maybe they didn't have enough knowledge against you. Maybe, I don't know, there is like a lot of reasons, you know?
Yeah.
And you have to take that in consideration.
And that's the same thing with sports as well. You can see some of the, like this past weekend, some of the greatest fighters look like absolute amateurs on one night. And you know, as you saw in my own run, you know, when I topped in Treasure Cup, my final round, we were both X1, and you saw how that Red Purple Law player played. A lot of people were like, what the hell is he doing? How is he X1 doing that? But you know, every game's different.
And some people in the chat, they were like, how the fuck Voodoo is X1 as well?
It's right, like, what right, right. But like what Jay was talking about is, you know, how can you adapt, adjust, and, you know, overcome in some situations? Because I think that's what separates a regular player from like a great player, right? It's like Jay never gave up in this game, even though he said, hey, you know, it was over by the third turn. But he's like, hey, you know, we're gonna keep trying to adjust. And I think that's what we get to see here. You know, that's why we're showing it off for stream and getting his insight here is how he thinks in order to adapt and overcome it, right?
And look, it keeps getting worse until the hand. I use Rocket, I draw a brick. It's Moria, which is fine, but it's still a brick because at this point, I don't want a brick, dude. I just want to survive, right?
Yep.
And guess what? We drew two more bricks.
Crazy.
Okay, and no, we cannot die because he only has two swings. We have one life, one broker. And oh, actually, we can die if he has another red rock. Never mind. If he has another red rock, wait, red rock is four? He already used two red rocks, so the odds of him having a third red rock are really low, and I'm not even sure he runs three. And if he used Gravity Blade, we still survive because he can only swing eight, and we can counter because we have 1-2K. So his only win con is a red rock right now. If he does not have it, then he's dead the next turn.
Mm-hmm.
Except if he, I mean, even if he plays a blocker, because we play Moria, we can get rid of it and swing 11. And now he just used the perfume and see he swing 8, but it's not enough.
Mm-hmm. And so that's the thing too. The Drummo says that I'm from Europe, so it can be different. Jay's also from Europe. he's also from Europe, dude. So I understand what you say.
I'm from Europe and I live with the kangaroos.
Yep.
It's fine.
But if this is the level on X1, I'm going to book the first flight. No, okay. Oh my god.
And that was the list that I was running, and I think it's the list that the one that topped in was it Australia actually? The one who lost in final? I don't remember.
Oh yeah, because they brought over the Kuzan finger pistol tech from Asia.
It was back then.
Yeah.
It was uh-huh. 3 weeks ago, so I don't really remember everything, but so there was this is one of the lists that first stopped pretty much, and now you can see how the list just adapt a little bit from that through the one who won in Liverpool, Flesh, the Jackson who won in NA.
Mm-hmm.
The list start to be a little bit similar, you know, like they do not run the same amount of stuff, and after that, it's pretty much up to preferences, I would say. I will show you a picture.
Yeah. And so, like what I said at the beginning too, this, you know, what Jay is doing here is kind of like just a basic insight into the way that he thinks playing Black, Yellow, Luffy, into his mindset. And I had some people ask me, you know, they want to play Black, Yellow, Luffy. They've been seeing it do well, but they don't know, you know, how to really pilot it. So preliminary stuff.
Did you get the picture that I sent you?
Oh.
Okay, so this is from the PDF that I give to my students after the session. Just let me know when you opened it.
Okay, I have it open.
Okay, so here, those 44 cards, they are the core of the deck that I would not change at all. Just because at the moment, Kuzan is so good overall in the meta, even though it makes your deck a little bit weaker against blue decks, you can still win those. And keep in mind that blue decks are not the deck that are the most represented at the moment, so there is no need for you to just take something that you might not see, pretty much, or not mm-hmm. face, if you, I don't know if you get my point.
Mm-hmm.
So Kuzan is probably the best fold on Scout that you can put in this deck, just because of the draw value, the threat that this card can just do. Like when it, against most of the leaders, whenever you just slam down Focus Kuzan, they're like, shit, it's problem are coming, you know? And this is so funny because BY is a deck that loves going second, but he doesn't have a single good fold on Scout except the Kuzan and Perona back then, but... other than that, they don't have a good fold on stern, pretty much, which is funny, right? The deck loves to go second, but they don't have any, they didn't have any good thing to do on four. So Kuzan, definitely a great card. And tell you what, meanwhile, everyone is just afraid of that Kuzan. As a BY player, you just don't give a fuck. That's simple. Kuzan dies, it's fine. On eight, you play Moria, Kuzan is back, and you make some value. Mm-hmm. And tell you what, you can even do better. You can play Kuzan into Garp, Kuzan into Flumpy, Kuzan into Hiyo. You can do so many stuff, right? For the rest, it's pretty simple. Flumpy, Hiyori, the best two cards that you can put in this deck. Moria, because Moria. Sabo, well, probably one of the best, if not the best blocker in the game. And then the babies, the big Luffy's. And then 8 searchers, because to me, 8 searchers is just, it's just too good. And I used to run 7, I tried 6, I tried a lot of stuff. And even my friend who keep telling me, he was like, dude, you should run 8 searchers. The one who won in Liverpool, Flesh. He said, you should play 8 searchers. And I was like, no, 7 is fine. I keep seeing my pieces. It's all right, you know, it's all right. And then I was in a Treasure Cup. And during 2 games, I bottom deck, like, I did 1 search and bottom deck 3 Morias. And I was like, fuck, I'm not going to see Moria the whole game, for sure. and on top of that, I was playing a little bit less searchers, probably 6 actually at that point. And I wasn't seeing my pieces neither. And I'm like, wait, because this is not normal. I need to see my pieces, right? And especially with that list, you run less babies, which means that you need even more searcher than usual to find your babies, right? Because without the babies, you cannot do the engine, right? So I'm like, I need to increase the searchers. And I realized another thing, it's free tip for you. And some, it might be too asking too much for some people, but you can, by playing 8 searchers, you add a new mechanic to this deck that some of other decks are doing. Decks such as Perona, Rebecca, Red Green Low. It's that you have the power to rebuild your deck. Because you play 8 searchers, you go through your whole deck that you can just rebuild it. Mm-hmm. And in that Treasure Cup, maybe I bottom deck 3 Morias. But if I was playing 8 searchers, I would have get them back. Because on average, you end the game, you have 20 to 25 cards left in the deck. Most likely something near 20. What is 20 cards? It's only 4 searchers. Only 4 searchers. Just imagine if you play 8, no? And that's why Perona just, after 4 turns, shifts into the whole deck, because she's just searching so much. And I'm not even talking about the draw power that the deck has. Kuzan, Rocket Luffy, Sabo, it's just insane. So even though you bottom deck the Moria, it's fine. You can find a way to get them back. If you stall the game long enough for that, you can, and if you search fast enough, you can just have them back. And you can see that actually in the semi-final at Nats in NA, when Jackson is playing against Chris Sock, I think it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He bottom decks most of his Moria, and you can see him spamming the searchers because he knows he has to just get everything back up, you know? He needs to find them back because it's going to be a grindy game. And if it's a grindy game, then you might see them again. And many times I've just been through the whole deck, and at high level or even at average level on the late game, if you know what are your next draw, you just won the game. That's simple. Your opponent doesn't know what he's going to draw. Meanwhile, you know everything that you're going to draw, and you can plan everything alongside that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's the reason why Edge Searcher for me is just that good at the moment.
Yeah, so this is what Jay would consider the 44 main cards in his deck here. So I know some people in chat, they're asking, no removal for Zoro is okay, but this is 44 cards. So there's There's still more cards that you can add to this deck list right here. These are just the
exactly.
core.
This is the core of the deck. So now you have six slots left.
Yes.
And then if you want to know the rest, then get the coaching session.
Yeah, then you got to get a coaching session. But yeah, what's going on? Dabble? He's his opinion on Ice Age in 08.
Ice Age is fine. So we were talking about Jackson earlier. Because Jackson ran one Ice Age. Mm-hmm. And when he sent me the deck list, I told him I used to run Ice Age for months. And the problem with Ice Age is that I used to run Ice Age because of Bonnie. And over the last three regionals that I've done, I faced four Bonnie. I won all of them. I was running Ice Age, and I've never played Ice Age. And I was like, bro, what the fuck? Like, I literally take that card for that matchup specifically and could be helpful in other ways.
Mm-hmm.
This card just almost never ended up being useful to me. I'm not saying it's bad, right? It's just not ended up being useful to me. So I was like, I should cut it down, right? Let's not play Ice. And I'd rather just play 10 cost Kuzan at this point because I know a little bit better how to play 10 cost Kuzan in a most efficient way than Ice Age, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And Jackson was like, dude, I feel the same. Like, he doesn't use Ice Age. He's like, I don't see it. And tell you what, Swiss round, day one. Last round against Perona. The reason why he won that Perona is only because he top decked the Ice Age.
Oh,
and
that's insane.
Literally the very, like, previous day, we were literally saying, we should cut Ice Age. Because that scenario just happened. He was like, okay, I'm not cutting Ice Age for sure. You know, there is no reason. He won the last round thanks to that. So
that's insane.
It's just up to preferences. You have six slots left. You could even cut some searchers. I would not recommend, but you can. You could cut Kuzan, the four-cost Kuzan, put it down to three. I would not recommend, but you can. And it's just up to preferences at this point. You know, there is like not a perfect answer to something. It's just up to you, your preferences, your meta call, what is being played a lot lately and stuff like that. And yeah, you just have to go with that. As long as you understand what's in your deck and how to drive it, there is nothing wrong.
Yeah.
By adding some other tech cards, you know?
Mm-hmm. And so, what are they asking here? Carl was saying, didn't get the PDF, bro.
I sent it to you, actually, and I send you the link for the GDoc, and I'm actually uploading it. But I can send it back one more time, if you want.
You're saying to me or to Carl?
To Carl.
Okay. All right. He said it to you.
You want the GDoc. Huh? Are you willing to play BY?
Oh, man. I don't know. I don't know about that. We'll see.
I mean, why not?
Maybe you gotta sweet talk me some more, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I show you how to play against BY already, so why not playing BY, you know?
Shit, man. He's trying to turn me to the dark side, you guys.
What do you mean the dark side? This is literally the last set where BY is gonna shine.
The dark side, man. It's like Jonas. Jonas was like, man, maybe I should have played BY at Nats.
Maybe. I mean, why not? What was he playing?
He was playing Lucci.
Oh, yeah.
It's crazy, though. He didn't encounter a single BY in Swiss on day one.
Not a single one?
Not a single BY, dude. I ate them all up for him, dude. Six BYs.
He made it to day two?
Yeah, he made it to day. But then he encountered BY round one.
Oh, yeah. I mean, for sure. You're going to see some BY for sure.
Yeah, yeah. That was tough.
But this is something that just blew my mind. Like, I keep telling people, I don't understand why BY is not popular in Europe, at least. Why people do not play BY. It's just because BY is just really punishing. And if you fail, you lose. And it's really, it's probably one of the hardest decks that we have in One Piece, to be fair, since the release of the game. The deck is just really, really complicated. And there is a lot of things to analyze and to understand. And every decision that you make and every mistake that you make, they all have a snowball effect. Like, you don't even realize it, but sometimes you make a mistake and you're going to pay it like four turns later. And you will be like, ah, oh, shit, I should have done that earlier, you know? And you can see it when I was playing against Noel, when he was playing the red purple low, you know. We did six games. I lose the four first one, and then I won the two last one. And do you remember what I said right before winning? I'm like, dude, I think I should counter that 5k swing in the early. With the way how I was playing, I should have countered it, you know. And right after I said that, I start changing and adapting a little bit, and then I won the two last one.
Yep.
But that small mistake that I was doing, I did not even realize it, like, for four games.
Yeah, that's insane.
Just because it's up to knowledge, and if your opponent has more knowledge than you, and if he knows the pros and cons of every move that you're going to make, and every move that he's going to make, then you're going to feel behind for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Big Alpha B, thanks so much for the love right there, man. I really appreciate that message, dude. Yeah, it's, in a way, I mean, you could say it's kind of like Sakazuki, dude. Sakazuki was such a strong deck, but a lot of people don't realize that, like, you know, the little things early on in the game can snowball so fast, you know, with the what you end up doing there.
Yeah, and definitely.
In a way, I think maybe that's why I've been able to perform better with Lucci, is because sometimes it's really nice to have it be more simplified and linear, especially with like the list that Noel made. It's different than the other Lucci lists, where it's like I have such an easy curve and I can just beat people down. It's like having that four cost Brook into six cost Brook into eight. It's just boom, boom, boom. And it's just super simple, consistent versus, you know, other decks that they run two ofs, one ofs and stuff like that. And so, yeah, I don't know. Maybe BY too complicated for me, bro. Who knows?
Yeah, but at the end of the day, you just have to play the game to realize some stuff and to just get better.
Whatever
you're playing. And it goes for every deck, even though some of the deck are easier than others, for sure. They are more linear. They have less options. And I think at the moment, BY is a little bit in a spot where he has some bad matchup, for sure. Like Bunny, you know, Perona, Rebecca, you know, they are bad matchup for him. But they are not unwinnable, you know. Mm-hmm. And it was a little bit the same for Sakaz, you know. He didn't have like any great like matchup where it was straight up instant win, but he could win everything, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I feel like BY is a little bit in that spot at the moment, where literally he can pretty much win everything because the toolbox is just that good.
Mm-hmm. No, very true, very true. But hey, man, I appreciate it. If you guys want to get coaching from Jay, he has coached multiple people in the chat, like Sosh, like Kaw. I saw you earlier, Sosh, man. Sorry I didn't say hi. It's always a little bit tough when we're doing these. I never want to talk or over interrupt Jay while he's on his train of thought. So, but yeah, thank you, man.
No worries. Always happy to explain a little bit, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. And he has Utrecht and Paris coming up for Nats. And so we hope that he can show off to the world how great of a player he is. And
we're prepping for that.
Yeah, we'll see, man. So thank you, brother.
No worries. Enjoy the rest of your stream.
Yep, thank you. I'll talk to you later. All right, that is the end of the video. If you guys enjoyed it, please consider subscribing, dropping a like, and commenting down below. It would really mean a lot. You guys can catch the shenanigans live on twitch.tv/Mr_Voodoo almost daily. And as always, good luck on your guys' pools. Let me know what you got in the comments down below, and stay winning.